Recorded Books and RB Digital present 6 Simple Rules, How to Manage Complexity Without Getting Complicated, by Yves Morieux and Peter Tollman. Narrated by Daniel Henning. Introduction. Why Managers Need the 6 Simple Rules. How do companies create value and achieve competitive advantage in an age of great complexity? This is a question we constantly ask ourselves as we go about our work of helping chief executives and their leadership teams build successful businesses. When we reflect on our work with the companies we've helped over the years, 500 or more in all kinds of industries in more than 40 countries, what we remember most vividly is rarely the specific problem that caused a business leader to call us in. Rather, what comes to mind is the people. An airline maintenance worker, a head of R&D, a hotel receptionist, a sales director, a train driver, a CEO, all of whom were facing more or less the same situation. They confronted a challenge that seemed impossible, increased complexity in their business. We'll discuss complexity in greater detail further along, but briefly, we mean that companies face an increasing number of performance requirements. The number can be in the range of 25 to 40 different requirements, far more than 20 or even 10 years ago. Often the requirements are contradictory in nature, such as the need to produce goods of high quality that can sell at low prices, or for services to be globally consistent yet also responsive to local demands. To meet the challenges of complexity, the people we remember so well had tried applying the best management thinking and following the best practices of the day, including, as we'll see, both structural fixes and people-oriented approaches. And those practices have failed to bring them success in their efforts in creating value. They were working hard, and when they failed to achieve the results they wanted, they worked harder. But they didn't have much hope the outcome would be any different. They felt overwhelmed, trapped, and often misunderstood and unsupported by their teams, bosses, and boards. What's striking is how poorly served these people were by the conventional wisdom in management, the management theories, models, and practices developed over the past 100 years. Instead of helping these people manage the growing complexity of business, all the supposed solutions only seemed to make things worse. There had to be a better way, and through on-the-ground work with these people and their organizations, we have battle-tested the approach that we describe in this book. We call this approach Smart Simplicity, and it hinges on the 6 simple rules. Yves comes at the issue as director of the Institute for Organization at the Boston Consulting Group, BCG, where he brings economics and social sciences to bear on the strategic and organizational challenges of companies and their executive teams, especially as they relate to complexity. Yves formulated the smart simplicity approach to managing complexity based on his background in research and theoretical inquiry, as well as his extensive work with clients in the United States, Europe, and Asia Pacific. As head of the firm's people and organization practice in North America, Peter has partnered with Yves to implement the 6 rules of the smart simplicity approach, drawing on his long experience working with some of the world's most prominent companies. Through our client work and continued research, we have continuously refined the rules so that they offer a theoretical framework and a set of practicable management tools. We're actively working together and with our BCG colleagues to successfully apply the simple rules, helping companies around the world grow, create enduring value, and achieve competitive advantage. How complexity leads to complicatedness. To understand the power of the simple rules and why they're so essential in business, let's start by defining the problem. Today, companies have to deal with greater business complexity than ever before. This complexity arises from the requirements companies must meet to create value for their stakeholders. These requirements have become more numerous, are changing faster, and what's more, are often in conflict with one another. We've actually measured this evolution and created what we call the BCG Complexity Index. It shows that business complexity has multiplied 6-fold since 1955. Some observers think increasing business complexity is the problem. we disagree. We believe that while complexity brings immense challenges, it also offers a tremendous opportunity for companies. Increasingly, the winners in today's business environment are those companies that know how to leverage complexity and exploit it to create competitive advantage. The real curse is not complexity so much as complicatedness, by which we mean the proliferation of cumbersome organizational mechanisms, structures, procedures, rules, and roles that companies put in place in an effort to deal with the mounting complexity of modern business. It is this internal complicatedness, with its attendant bureaucracy, that destroys a company's ability to leverage complexity for competitive advantage. Even worse, this organizational complicatedness destroys a company's ability to get anything done. However, although complicatedness is a curse, it is not the fundamental root cause of the problem. It is, as we shall see, only a byproduct of outdated, ineffectual, and irrelevant management thinking and practices. But first, it's necessary to understand just how pervasive and troubling the phenomenon of organizational complicatedness really is. We've done research into the rise of complicatedness, and the findings are striking. Over the past 15 years, the number of procedures, vertical layers, interface structures, coordination bodies, scorecards, and decision approvals has increased dramatically, between 50% and 350%, depending on the company. This rapid rise in complicatedness is shocking. What also surprised us is that our analysis shows absolutely no correlation between the size of companies and their degree of complicatedness. A big company is just as likely to be relatively uncomplicated, compared to the average index, as a small company is to be very complicated. Nor is there any correlation between complicatedness and the degree of diversification. The diversity of the business portfolio does not automatically increase complicatedness. What matters, then, is not the size of the company or the number of businesses in which it competes. What matters is how the resulting business complexity is managed. Complicatedness spells trouble for a company's performance and productivity, trapping people in non-value-adding activities and causing waste and overconsumption of resources of all kinds: equipment, systems, inventories, committees, and teams. Complicatedness also has a pronounced negative effect on a company's ability to formulate a winning business strategy, causing it to miss new opportunities and fail to meet new challenges. As we've witnessed firsthand, complicatedness has deleterious effects on the human beings who are trapped in such organizations, inevitably leading to frustration, dissatisfaction, and disengagement. Indeed, we think that organizational complicatedness is the primary reason that disengagement and dissatisfaction at work have become so damaging. Surveys by the Conference Board show that the percentage of Americans who are satisfied at work declined from 61% in 1987 to 47% in 2011. Studies abound on stress, burnout, work-related suicide, even death from exhaustion. The Japanese have a word for it: karoshi. Some argue that declining engagement is a cause of the stagnant productivity that affects companies, industries, and societies in many parts of the world. Is it poor engagement that saps productivity? Or is it the pressure to improve productivity and the discouragement people feel when efforts fail that undermine engagement at work? This chicken and egg discussion is irrelevant. Whenever we've intervened on such issues, we've always found that employee disengagement and stagnant productivity are triggered by a common factor: organizational complicatedness. The root causes of complicatedness. But as we've hinted, complicatedness is itself only a byproduct, a symptom of the real problem. To understand the root causes of complicatedness, we must go deeper to explore a set of deeply ingrained assumptions that guide how companies have responded to complexity. In struggling with the problem, most organizations have relied on two approaches with a long history in management theory and practice. We refer to them as the hard approach and the soft approach, and they are the product of two major revolutions in management theory and practice during the 20th century and, unfortunately, remain to this day the two basic pillars of modern management. Almost all management thinking and best practice today is based on one of these two approaches, and usually a combination of the two, be it for restructuring, reorganizing, cultural transformation, reengineering, or improving engagement or motivation. The hard approach to management. The hard approach is the product of more than a century of managerial thinking that began with Frederick W. Taylor's work on scientific management. It was further developed in the discipline of industrial engineering and continues to this day in practices such as reengineering, restructuring, and business process design. The hard approach rests on two fundamental assumptions. The first is the belief that structures, processes, and systems have a direct and predictable effect on performance. And as long as managers pick the right ones, they will get the performance they want. So, for example, if you want your employees to customize your offering to local market demands, you choose a decentralized organizational structure. If you want to leverage economies of scale, you choose a centralized structure, and so on. The second assumption is that the human factor is the weakest and least reliable link of the organization, and that it is essential to control people's behavior through the proliferation of rules to specify their actions and through financial incentives linked to carefully designed metrics and key performance indicators, KPIs, to motivate them to perform in the way the organization wants them to. Perhaps the hard approach made sense in the past, but it is dangerously counterproductive in today's complex business environment. When the company needs to meet new performance requirements, the hard response is to add new structures, processes, and systems to help satisfy those requirements. Hence the introduction of the innovation czar, the risk management team, the compliance unit, the customer centricity leader, Mr. Quality in Chief, and the cohort of coordinators and interfaces that have become so common in companies. The soft approach to management. But the hard fixes have some squeaky wheels that need greasing. And to do that, companies turn to what we call the soft approach. Practices such as team building, people initiatives, affiliation events, offsite retreats, and the like, all added on top of the work itself, so that people will feel better at work and work better together. The soft approach has its main origins in the work of Elton Mayo in the 1920s, which led to the development of the human relations school of management. According to this perspective, an organization is a set of interpersonal relationships and the sentiments that govern them. Good performance is the byproduct of good interpersonal relationships. What people do is predetermined by personal traits, so-called psychological needs and mindsets. In other words, to change behavior at work, change the mindset, or change the people. At first glance, the soft approach may seem like the antithesis to the hard approach, but it isn't. Both seek to control the individual. The only difference lies in the fact that the soft approach assumes that what really matters is emotional rather than financial stimuli. Emotional stimuli include affiliation activities, celebrations of all kinds, and the display of appropriate leadership styles. The dynamic that these two responses to complexity produce goes something like this. The hard approach raises new obstacles for people and contributes to dissatisfaction and disengagement. Because people feel bad and ineffective, managers use the soft approach, ostensibly to help them feel and work better. Managers then assume they've addressed the problem, even though they've only addressed the symptoms. Paradoxically, this puts the onus for any continuing disengagement on the victims themselves. If problems persist, and of course they always do, it must be because there's something wrong with the psychology of the people involved. They have a bad attitude or the wrong mindset. They just don't get it. As we shall see in some of our company examples, at its worst, the soft approach can become a disguise for simple prejudice and stereotyping, for example, about the attitudes of women or young people in the workforce, leading to an enormous waste of talent and compounding ineffectiveness with injustice. Hard and soft approaches are the root problem. In our experience, complexity can only be addressed by people using their judgment in the moment. People's autonomy is therefore essential to deal with complexity. No amount of structure, planning, or formal rules and procedures will ever be enough to anticipate the kinds of problems people on the front line of the business will face, solutions they will need to innovate, or new opportunities they will recognize. In this respect, the human factor isn't the weak link, something to be minimized and worked around. Rather, it is the key resource for coping with complexity. Companies need to invest in and trust the intelligence and ingenuity of their people by expanding their autonomy and room for maneuver. Only then will employees be able to make judgments, balance complex trade-offs, find creative solutions to new problems, and do the right thing, making the best use of the available information and interpreting the rules to fulfill the spirit and not just the letter of the law. Simply piling up structure upon structure and multiplying procedures and formal rules, including some that contradict each other, with the hard approach only adds new obstacles to dealing with complexity. It is also in the nature of complexity that no one individual has the entire answer. So it is equally necessary that people use their autonomy to cooperate with each other. Companies need to encourage, and indeed impel, people to perform their specialized tasks in a way that also enhances the effectiveness of others. But the more people cooperate, the harder it becomes to determine who contributed what to the ultimate solution. The proliferation of metrics and incentives of the hard approach not only adds to complicatedness, but actually obstructs the kind of cooperation necessary to deal with business complexity. These two characteristics, autonomy and cooperation, are precisely what the hard approach seeks to eliminate. Its goal is to immunize the organization against the perceived risks inherent in people's autonomy and to minimize the need for cooperation. The belief is that if the structures, processes, and systems are adequate, and that if everyone has received the necessary training and the right incentives, then everyone can remain within their silos, do what they have to do, and there will be no need for cooperation. As for the soft approach, it negates people's autonomy in using their intelligence because it views the individual's decisions and actions as Pavlovian responses to psychological needs and emotional stimuli, just as the hard approach views these decisions and actions as Pavlovian responses to financial stimuli. Moreover, as we will see in the next chapters, the emphasis on good interpersonal feelings, typical of the soft approach, creates obstacles to cooperation. Cooperation has nothing to do with a touchy-feely conviviality. The two pillars of current management practices are unable to handle the new challenges the corporations face. As the hard and soft approaches are being stretched beyond their limitations, companies have to resort to stitches and patches in their structure and management processes that not only fail to address complexity, but also make failure increasingly costly for all stakeholders. The doom loop of management. The encounter between business complexity and the hard and soft approaches triggers a chain reaction of complicatedness and a doom loop for organizations. In front of the new complexity, the hard and soft attempts to control individuals can only create complicatedness. Complicatedness leads to stagnant productivity and disengagement, which then feed off each other. In response, companies redouble their efforts with more hard fixes and soft initiatives, which only serve to make the problem worse. But as we shall see, there is another way. Smart simplicity. The simple rules are a way for managers to break out of this doom loop and start moving beyond the hard and soft approaches in order to deal effectively with business complexity. The primary goal is to create more value by better managing business complexity. However, as managers peel away the stitches and patches that have accumulated through the use of approaches that are obsolete in today's world, the byproduct is also the elimination of complicatedness and its attendant costs. In this respect, the simple rules constitute a third revolution in management, smart simplicity. By helping manage complexity and remove complicatedness, the simple rules allow organizations simultaneously to improve performance and engagement. What's more, the doom loop is transformed into a virtuous circle. Better performance leads to more opportunities for people. More opportunities generate more engagement. More engagement nurtures higher aspirations and contributes to even better performance. The rules are based on the premise that the key to managing complexity is the combination of autonomy and cooperation. These are two words that people rarely think of as going together, but it is precisely the combination of the two that is required to handle complexity without complicatedness. Individual autonomy harnesses people's flexibility and agility. Meanwhile, cooperation brings synergy so that everyone's efforts are multiplied in the most effective way for the group. The purpose of the simple rules is to create situations in which each person's autonomy, in using judgment and energy, is made more effective by the rest of the group, and in which people put their autonomy in the service of the group. The rules are designed to create an organizational context in which cooperation becomes the best choice for each individual. In other words, these rules help organize and manage in a way that makes cooperation an individually useful behavior, a rational strategy for people. The simple rules do not aim at controlling employees by imposing formal guidelines and processes. Rather, they create an environment in which employees work together to develop creative solutions to complex challenges. The cooperation achieved thanks to the simple rules is such that, at any time, people are mutually advantaged and impelled by others to come up with the right solutions to deal with performance requirements, even if what is right cannot be specified in advance. Simplifying in a naive way, by ignoring or discarding business complexity, is a dead end. You have to be smart and play on people's smartness. You have to recognize business complexity and simplify in a way that leverages people's intelligence and judgment. The combination of autonomy and cooperation allows you to do this. Why not fewer than 6 rules? We know that the 6 rules cannot be boiled down to fewer rules because no rule can be deducted from the 5 others. None of the 6 rules is superfluous. Vice versa, we've never encountered a situation in which the solution would not be a combination of some of the 6 rules. It is not necessary to add another rule. Together, the 6 rules constitute a minimum sufficient set to confront complexity. The first 3 rules are designed to give people an advantage in the way they mobilize their intelligence and energy at work by providing them with relevant knowledge, room for maneuver, power, and the resource of cooperation. The first simple rule is about understanding what people do and why they do it. The second rule is about the utilization of power to foster cooperation. The third rule is about the production of power. These first 3 rules create the conditions for individual autonomy so that its effectiveness can be multiplied through cooperation from others. Simple rules 4, 5, and 6 are designed to impel people to confront complexity and to use their autonomy to cooperate with others by embedding feedback loops that expose them as directly as possible to the consequences of their actions without the need for extra supervision and structure or for the bureaucracy of compliance metrics and incentives. The 4th and 5th rules create direct feedback loops that are intrinsically embedded into work processes and activities. The direct feedback loops created by the 4th rule are based on interdependencies, space, so to speak. The feedback loops of the 5th rule are based on time, directly gratifying or penalizing people depending on how well they do today for tomorrow. When work processes do not allow for direct feedback loops, management intervention is needed as a last resort to close them through evaluation. This is the role of the 6th rule. In summary, the first 3 rules use the group effect to give people's autonomy an advantage in best using their energy and judgment, while the last 3 rules impel people to put their autonomy in the best service of the group. Whenever people apply their full energy and intelligence to the greater range of possible solutions that arises from cooperation, they are bound to reach superior solutions to those predefined or hardwired in procedures and structures, and to the loose compromises of collaboration within informal, consensus-seeking groups. By calling the rules simple, we don't mean to imply that they are necessarily easy to put into practice. Using them requires managers to think differently and work differently. Nor do we mean that managers should pursue simplification as a goal in itself. What we do mean, however, is that these rules allow executives to create competitive advantage by exploiting complexity without getting complicated. The scientific basis of the six simple rules. The six rules are based on fundamental developments in the social sciences that can be traced back to the work of Herbert Simon and Thomas Schelling. Simon received the Nobel Prize in 1978 for his study of decision-making, and Schelling in 2005 for his game-theoretic work on conflicts and cooperation. Simon's research brought a radically new perspective on cognitive processes, how the individual decides and acts, while Schelling's helped us better understand interactions between individuals and the effect of these interactions on overall results, which can be very different from their individual intent. Other important intellectual contributors are Michel Crozier and Robert Axelrod. Crozier started his career by studying labor movements in the United States after World War II, and then created a new approach called the strategic analysis of organizations. Axelrod is a political scientist who has helped us better understand cooperation as an evolutionary process and also coined concepts we've used to name some of the simple rules. These developments have led to a variety of new perspectives on organizations and to useful insights about human behavior that are extremely relevant to how organizations manage complexity. For example, human behavior is strategic. People adapt to their environment strategically, in the sense that game theory uses the term, in order to fulfill certain objectives or goals. They may be more or less conscious of those goals, but the goals can be identified by studying carefully how they act. In this respect, human behavior can always be analyzed as a rational strategy in an individual's context. There are always good reasons, in the sense of reasons with explanatory power, for how people behave. Formal rules and procedures don't have a predetermined effect on people's behavior. Rather, people actively interpret rules and use them as a resource to fulfill their goals. What matters are not the rules, but the ways people use them. Cooperation isn't just some taken-for-granted value or goal, the desire that people work together as a team. It is a complex social process, hard to create and easy to destroy. Organizations have to create the right context for cooperation. Power isn't a necessary evil or source of coercion. It is a critical resource for the individual in organizations and for mobilizing collective action. These concepts are the basis on which the six rules operate and why these rules work, especially given the complexity that is making all traditional hard and soft management approaches obsolete. Our focus with the six simple rules has been on making these concepts actionable. That is, to help managers to use them in their day-to-day work running business organizations. You can think of the six simple rules as guidelines for practice, because all performance issues arrive from people's actions, decisions, and interactions, what we call behaviors in this book. The six rules provide the basis for tackling the whole lineup of organizational challenges, including productivity, innovation, growth, and cultural transformation. Getting started. Each of the six chapters of this book is organized around one of the simple rules. The purpose of the simple rules is to let managers really manage, to use the tools that managers have always used, strategy setting and organizational design, but for a different end and a far more effective outcome. The rules help managers foster both autonomy and cooperation to effectively handle business complexity and prevent much organizational complicatedness. Unlike other recent books that propose new roles for managers, we focus less on psychological issues of individual motivation and one-to-one interactions, and more on managing large-scale situations and the collective properties, for instance, productivity and innovation, that emerge from multiple interactions among groups, units, and teams. There's a lot of loose talk these days about self-organizing systems and the end of management. Let's be clear. We believe in the essential role of management. But we contend that traditional methods, developed for a different, less complex era, are obsolete, or fast becoming so. Let's begin then with the first fundamental rule of management, Simple Rule 1. Understand what your people do. The Complexity Challenge and Opportunity. Performing on everything for everyone. The BCG Institute of Organization created the Complexity Index by tracking the evolution of the number of performance requirements at a representative sample of companies in the United States and Europe over a period of 55 years, from 1955, the year the Fortune 500 list was created, through 2010. In 1955, companies typically committed to between 4 and 7 performance imperatives. Today, they commit to between 25 and 40. Between 15% and 50% of those performance requirements are contradictory. Around 1955, hardly any were. Companies currently may have to offer high-quality products and sell them at rock-bottom prices. Goods have to be innovative and also produced efficiently. Supply chains must be fast and reliable. Service must be globally consistent and, at the same time, highly responsive locally. When a company is able to reconcile valuable yet contradictory requirements...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.